Thank you, Anissa, for reminding me. So I just start recording it. Okay, we have 60 so far joining. The remaining 27, 28. Okay, let's give another 1 minute. Okay, so we shall start now. Alright? So there are 8 questions altogether. The following statements are true except which one? So please look at your phone. The first law asserts that energy is a thermodynamic property. Energy can change from one form to another. Total amount of energy remains constant despite the transformation. Heat flows in the direction of increasing temperature. The remaining jawab. Okay, only 8 of you be able to answer faster. So the answer is actually heat flows in the direction of decreasing temperature. Okay, these are all true except that heat flows in the direction of decreasing temperature. Dia kalau from, if let's say you have a hot water, then it's actually that temp from the heat will flow from the hot water to the cold surrounding. So you have to remember that. If let's say the cold surrounding ni, you nak increase the temperature of the cold surrounding, you need to do work. Okay. Heat is something that flow naturally from the and in the direction of decreasing temperature. So that's number one. Okay, well done to the first 8 who answer correctly. So far, Yiting answer the fastest, right? The next question. The following are the application of thermodynamics, except, okay, air conditioner, refrigerator, aquarium, and mobile phone. Okay, the answer is aquarium. So aquarium ni, the concept is not based on thermodynamics lah. Whenever that you want to set up the aquarium, mobile phone, computer, television, iron, kettle, everything is based on the thermodynamics concept. Okay. Next question. So you see who's leading for now. Muhammad is the fastest. Next question. The following are secondary dimension, except if you recall back the slide of dimension, they are primary and secondary. So which one is not secondary dimension? Volume, area, electric current, energy, or velocity? Okay, the answer is supposed to be electric current. Sebab volume is actually a combination of length. Length multiply with another length, multiply with another length. So that is actually a derived dimension. Area is also the same. It's multiplication of length times length. Okay, then you got area. Energy is a multiplication of many ni lah, mass, force and so on. Velocity also is actually meter per second, right? So it's meter, the length divided by time. So you got velocity. but electric current is ampere. So the unit is ampere, so it is a primary dimension. Okay. So we have Chacha is leading. Okay. Next question. The following are the right matching of answer. Except, okay, please look at your phone. Surroundings is the mass origin outside the system. Isolated, no energy transfer across boundary, but mass transfer happen. System, a quantity of matter or oxygen in space chosen for study. Boundary is the surface that separates the system from its surrounding. Okay, the answer is isolated. The definition of isolated is there is no energy and mass transfer across boundary could happen. Okay, so that is what is meant by isolated system. If you recall the isolated the system, there are three types of system. One, it is open system. Okay. Now the second one is closed system, and the third one is isolated system. So the open system, there is a crossing of mass transfer. There is also heat transfer happen. If let's say it is a closed system, it is just heat transfer or energy transfer happen. If it is isolated system, there is nothing, no transfer at all between the system and the surrounding. Okay. So the other definition is correct. For example, you need to know about system. What is a system? Okay. You choose for your. If let's choose it's a system, but outside of it is considered as surrounding. Okay. Boundary is actually the surface. From. It can be real. It can be imaginary as well. It can be something that we define. Okay. So that is isolated system that is wrong. Okay, now we have Yong Jin is leading. The next question, 5 of 8. The following are the properties of a system, except which one? Okay, so you have to recall first, what is the property? Okay, number of cycles N, temperature T, thermal conductivity K, pressure P, specific gravity SG. Which one is not property? Okay, so it's supposed to be number of cycle. Number of cycle ni tak tahu apa dia. It's nothing. It got nothing to do with properties. Okay. It's a made up things. Yang lain-lain tu, it is a property. Temperature. For example, like you have a state. At the moment, our surrounding. What is the temperature of our surrounding? What is the temperature? For example, like if let's say I take a pencil case. So you can tell actually from this pencil case, what is the temperature of this pencil case at the moment? What is the thermal conductivity? You can tell from it. You can also tell the pressure. You can also tell density, specific gravity, and so on. Okay. If let's say you have a liquid in a bottle, you can also explain about the temperature, pressure, and so on. But you cannot explain number of cycle is nothing, meaningless, right? So properties is it is the properties of the system. Okay, properties of the system ialah keadaan during of the system at that particular state. Next question. So we still have Yong Jin as leading, followed by Muhammad. Okay, the next question. If a system involves two phases and when the mass of each phase reach an equilibrium level and stays there, this present what of equilibrium is? Is it chemical, phase, mechanical, or thermal equilibrium? Okay, the answer is supposed to be phase equilibrium. Okay, because it mentioned here, it involves two phases, and when the mass of each phase reach an equilibrium level and stays there. So imagine you have water, okay? So you have two phases of water. One is in ice, solid condition. Another one, it is in liquid condition. So both of it, there is no transfer of phase. For example, like solid doesn't change anymore, become liquid. Liquid doesn't anymore become solid at that particular time. So we call it, it achieved phase equilibrium. Okay. So you will learn more right after this. Eh? So the answer is phase equilibrium. Okay. So this is Muhammad is leading right now. Okay. The second last question. If there is a change that makes the system undergoes from one equilibrium to state to another, this is called as what? Path, process, or cycle? Is it a path? Is it a process? Or is it a cycle? If there is a change that makes the system undergoes from one equilibrium state to another. Okay, the answer is process, right? It is not a cycle, it is not a path, okay? Because it's actually, the path is the route that the state change from, let's say from state number one until state number two, it can have different path that it choose to go to that direction. The process is the change. Okay, for example, from state number one to state number two. State number one, imagine if let's say you have a vapor and then you want to change into state number two, which is a liquid. So the process that it undergoes is condensation, for example. So that condensation is called as process. Okay, you got it right here. Okay, so we have getting back in the leak. Okay, final question. For a process that changes the pressure and temperature at constant volume, this is called, what type of process is it? Is it isothermal or isochoric? For a process that changes the pressure and temperature at constant volume, this is called as... Okay, the answer is isochoric process, okay? Because this is as constant volume. If it constant temperature, it is isothermal. If it constant pressure, then we call it isobaric, okay? You can have both at the same time as well. For example, like it's a changing volume at constant pressure and temperature. You can have a changing temperature at constant pressure and volume. I mean, both, sometimes all these conditions can come. More than one condition can come at one time. Okay. Okay. So let me see who's leading finally. Okay. So we have Yiting as a winner. Congratulations, Yiting. So I'm going to snapshot of this. Sorry. If in case in the future, okay, if in case in the future Yiting won again one to time, then perhaps I'll be considering giving some reward. But if let's say anyone else consistently get at the top top marks, then perhaps you'll be able to get the reward lah in the future. Okay, reward tu tengoklah sama ada apa-apalah that I can think of, right? Okay, so let's move to our slide back. Okay, this is actually some examples for you to consider from the lesson, previous lesson, for which that you need to make some kind of calculation. I think that just because of the time that we have, we may not be sufficient. I'll give you the answer, the tutorial, how to do this calculation later, okay? But it's very straight to the point and you can be able to just one simple calculation that we're able to get the answer from this. It's just a calculation of how to get vacuum, for example, like determining the pressure, absolute pressure. Okay. So the learning outcome for today's lecture is to explain the concept of energy and define its various forms. So we will learn about how does the energy, the concept of energy, and how we could define it from various forms. We should be able to define the concept of heat and work, and we should be able to describe the first law of thermodynamics, energy balances, and mechanism of energy transfer to or from a system. Okay. So this is something that I would like you to ponder. Consider this is an insulated room. Okay, this is a well-sealed and well-insulated room, right? And then there is no window. It's tightly closed. So now you have a refrigerator in this particular room with its open door, and plug it into a wall outlet. So there is a plug here, okay? And then the fridge door is open lah, okay? So what do you think will happen to the average temperature of the air in the room? Will it be increasing or decreasing, or will it remain constant? Okay. How many of you feel that the room temperature stay the same, or the room temperature reduced, or room temperature increase? I'm not going to tell you the answer immediately, okay? Because you will be able to get the answer along the way once we go through the lecture. But this is something for you to ponder first. If let's say you have that kind of refrigerator in an isolated room, what do you think will happen? Whether the room temperature will reduce, whether the room temperature will increase, or room temperature stay the same. Okay, so this is what we got from you. So majority of you feel that room temperature will reduce. Okay, never mind. So first of all, it's actually we need to classify the energy first in terms of the thermodynamics. So when you learn about the energy, when we learn about the energy, there are two types of energy, group of energy, not two types of energy. There are forms of energy is something else. Form of energy is something like we call thermal, mechanical, chemical, kinetic energy, potential, electric, and so on. But groups of energy, there are two types of group of energy. One is called macroscopic, another one is microscopic. Okay, so microscopic ni is actually related to motion. For example, like something got to do with effect. There is a gravity, there is a magnetism, there is a electricity, surface tension. For example, if you imagine that if you remember last 2 weeks about the rock falling down, kan? So the rock falling down from the potential energy is changed into the kinetic energy, and then it's further transformed into elastic and sounds and so on. So this is a group of what we call as microscopic energy. But there is another group of energy, we call it as microscopic of energy, which is related to the molecular structure of a system and degree of the molecular activity. This is something that you cannot see. It is inside the system. Okay, it is inside the system that cannot be able to be seen by our own eyes. For example, okay, if let's say you have a bottle of water, okay? So you have a bottle of water. Even if let's say there is nothing that you did to this water, there are still some kind what we call a macroscopic energy inside here. Okay. There is a molecular that is actively or the atoms inside the water, which is actually providing this what we call as macroscopic energy. And this is what we call as internal energy. So internal energy, okay, or denoted as U, is the sum of all the microscopic forms of energy. So inside, for example, inside the bottle itself, the water itself, for example, it has its own potential energy. It has its own kinetic energy. It has its own different type of energy, which actually, when you sum up everything, then this is what we call as internal energy. So internal energy represent microscopic energy. Okay, But the other form of energy that you can see, for example, like the kinetic, electric, chemical, nuclear, and so on, this is what we call as macroscopic energy. So the microscopic forms of energy itself, okay, you remember the microscopic here. So it is further divided into two type of energy. There are the dua energy lagi yang it makes the microscopic form of energy. First one is what we call as potential energy, because there is an elevation in a gravitational field, okay, because they are the different of different height, kan? So you have a gravitational field and then you have a different height. You put the object or the system at different height, so it acquires different potential energy. But at the same time, it also have kinetic energy. For example, like it is resulting of motion relative to some reference frame. For example, like what happened here. Contohnya dalam water itself, you imagine the molecule of water, eh? There is a molecular translation. Okay, there is a rotation of molecular punya dalam water tu. There is an electron translation, there is some vibration, there is some spinning and so on. So this is where actually it makes the kinetic energy in the microscopic form. So if let's say we are looking at internal energy, okay, U, it is is the sum of all form of the microscopic energy. So if let's say you want to define the U itself, internal energy for this, is actually the summation of kinetic energy as well as the potential energy. So it defines the internal energy, because dalam the system itself, there are actually different type of molecule which move at different direction. Okay. So if we consider, for example, hydroelectric dam. Okay. If you remember, kalau kat Perlis ni kita tak ada hydroelectric dam, kita ada empangan timah tasuh. Okay. Tapi kita ada few, for example, dekat Perak kita ada hydroelectric dam. So there is a transformation of energy that happen here, okay. But then there is also some microscopic energy that is also you can see from here. And the question here: what turns the wheel? Is it microscopic energy or macroscopic energy? What do you think? Okay. So if you can think of right now, what are the example of energy transformation at a hydroelectric dam? What do you think? What kind of energy transformation? If let's say you have an hydroelectric dam, dia daripada energy apa bertukar jadi energy apa? Water energy tu you have to be specific. What type of energy yang ada kat situ? There is no solar energy, bang. Tak ada solar energy kat situ. Got nothing to do with solar. Okay. Alright. Okay, the answer is actually, this is a correct one. It is the potential energy. That's why dam tu dekat tempat yang tinggi. Okay, dam tempat yang tinggi. It's a potential energy. Lepas tu, dia lalu kat turbine, okay? There is a turbine, a spinning turbine, so that is actually kinetic energy, because from the potential energy it flows to become kinetic energy, and that turbine generates electric. So now after that it becomes electrical energy. So there are three type of energy happening from over there, which is the potential, and then the kinetic, and then the turbine spin is actually converted into electrical energy. Okay, so my question is actually, what are the microscopic and macroscopic energy here? What do you think? Which one is microscopic? Which one is macroscopic? For example, just now we defined there is a potential energy. There is kinetic punya energy, and there's also electrical punya energy. Waterfall, micro, turbine, micro. Okay, what else? Which one is actually micro? Which one is actually micro? Okay. So micro kinetic and potential, micro electrical, microscopic kinetic and microscopic potential and kinetic, microscopic electrical, potential and kinetic microscopic, while electric in microscopic. Micro kinetic and potential, micro potential, micro kinetic. Okay. Okay. I think most of you got things incorrect here. I think because you have not further explained detail. Okay. So let's have a look back at the dam. Okay. Kita tengok balik dekat dam tadi. Right. So this is a dam, okay, gambarnya, and then there is a kinetic energy. So it's from high place, from potential high potential energy, dia akan turun kinetic energy, and dekat sini ada turbine. So turbine ni akan pusing, so that is what actually dia akan generate electric. So the macroscopic energy is actually combining potential energy, kinetic energy as well as electrical energy as a whole. Itu microscopic energy. Tapi microscopic energy apa? Dalam air kat sini, dia ada small molecule of water which is actually rotating, vibrating and so on. And dia memang unorganized. Okay. So in term of your answer just now tadi, you try to straight away terus classify, okay, electrical is micro, potential and kinetic is micro. That is not correct. You have to define potential and kinetic energy in the molecular activity of water is considered a microscopic energy. Tapi as a whole kinetic and potential energy ni is considered as microscopic. Okay. So kalau you tengok dekat sini, gambar dekat sini, okay, this is a dam. Ada water kat sini, okay? And then there is a turbine, okay? So bila the microscopic energy ni is actually the small molecules kat sini. This does not turn the wheel. Okay? Tapi microscopic kinetic energy, this is the one that turns the wheel. For example, like the kinetic, because you can see that right now kan, nampak kan, ada dua bentuk kinetic energy kat sini. One is microscopic kinetic energy, another one is macroscopic kinetic energy. So kalau you nampak macam small-small molecule just bergerak tak tentu arah tu, that is a still kinetic energy, tapi that is considered as microscopic. For those yang bergerak satu arah, yang bergerak everybody, everything is moving towards the same direction dalam quantity yang banyak, that is what we call as microscopic kinetic energy. Okay? So the microscopic kinetic energy, it is an organized form of energy and is much more useful than this disorganized microscopic kinetic energies. So kalau kita tengok kat sini, microscopic, okay, MICRO, is actually molecular water ni, for example, molecule kat sini yang bergerak tak tentu arah tadi. It is unorganized. Tapi when it goes into one direction, okay, when it goes into one direction and everything, this is where actually it become more organized. So this is what we call as microscopic kinetic energy. So kalau kita define total energy of a system, alright, so if you want to know what will be the total energy at that particular point, for example, like before it converted into electrical energy, for example, then it is the summation of the internal energy U, okay, which is the microscopic MICRO, and then you have also additional with KE and PE, so kinetic energy and potential energy, and this is the formula for kinetic energy and this is for potential energy lah, okay, plus with U, then only then you'll be able to get total energy. So if let's say you divide by unit mass, so divide by unit mass, then you got a different notation, okay, small e equals to U plus KE plus PE, which is also you divide this by mass, then you just get U plus V squared over 2 plus GZ, okay, this is kilojoule per kilogram. So that is the difference between macroscopic and microscopic energy. In a way that we are more concerned about the macroscopic energy, especially when it comes to open and closed system. Okay. But when it is only isolated system, the internal energy, only then it make it makes different. Okay, only the internal energy change in the isolated system. If we look at a heat and work in thermodynamics, because we are very particularly interested in thermodynamics, right? And we want to know, we are very concerned on how heat can be transformed into another form of energy, right? So for example, like this sumo punya guy ni kan, dia actually macam mana dia dapat energy in? Dia makan lah kan? Dia makan 5 units, okay? That is from the food intake, he got the energy. And then lepas tu, ada some yang dia akan guna, dia akan simpan dalam badan dia, 1 unit. And then the remaining 4 unit tu dia guna untuk dia bersumo. Okay? He will use for sumo. So that is where actually we wanted to know how does the energy is balanced it out. So the concept of the thermodynamics, okay, the first law of thermodynamics is there is a conservation of energy. Okay? Which means that energy ni cannot be created or cannot be destroyed. But energy can be changed into something else. So in this particular case, he got the energy from the food. And then he has something inside his body, okay, that he stored in his body. But at the same time, some of other energy, he turned it into activity yang diguna untuk, contohnya bersumo, for example. So if you add on together, 1 + 4 will be equivalent to 5, which is the amount of that he consumed is supposed to be equals to the amount of what it is being stored plus what is the amount of energy being spent. Okay, so this is where actually the conservation of energy comes in. So the first law of thermodynamics clearly highlight that energy, as I mentioned, cannot be created nor can be destroyed, but it can be transformed from one form to another. That is the first law of thermodynamics. And then the most important part is actually we wanted to know about the closed system. Okay, in a closed system, if you imagine an open system, there is a mass transfer can happen. Okay, mass transfer can happen, but in a closed system, only energy can cross the boundaries. Okay, and energy, if let's say you have a system, energy can cross the boundary. As I, for example, if let's say I hit this bottle, okay, this is actually, it's a closed, this is a, what we call as closed system, sebab kita tutup. Kita tutup, okay, the bottle, and then you put some heat, you give provide some heat inside here, okay. So in a closed system, you know that the amount of water dekat sini, it will still be trapped inside here, okay. So if even if let's say you boil it, the water will change into vapor, tapi it cannot get out from the system because it is a closed system. But what can be transferred is energy. Okay, the energy can transfer. For example, like the heat from here, okay, so daripada air ni sejuk 25 degree, it can become up to 100 degree Celsius. So there is some energy inside here. And then there's also energy that leave the system, the heat that leave the system, okay, because lama-lama bila kita dah panaskan, lepas tu kita sejukkan, kita tutup api, and then air ni panas kan? Tapi after we leave it for a while, even if it's a closed system, you start to notice that the temperature of this water will drop because the heat is released out to the surrounding, from the system to the surrounding. Okay, so this is where actually the example of a closed system lah. Energy can cross the boundaries but not the mass in a closed system. So for a heat, the form of energy that is transferred between two systems is by virtue of a temperature difference. As I'm, dalam kita buat quiz tadi kan, the heat will flow naturally from a high temperature to the low temperature. So in this particular case, kalau kita nak, if let's say there is a hot water inside here at 100 degrees Celsius, you pour in hot water, you close the tap, and then after that, if you leave it for a while, after 10 minutes, you'll start to see that the temperature is dropping, of water is dropping because the heat is being transferred out. Okay, it is happening naturally. Tapi kalau air ni sejuk, in order for us to really make the air ni naik temperature dia, you have to put some work. In this particular case, we can heat it up. Okay, then we put some, it gives some work. So the water, only then the water temperature will increase. Okay, so that's a different, I think we have to highlight the significant difference between heat and work. Okay. Alright. Again, the question here is heat or work? Okay, So in this particular case, okay, this is a system, okay? There is a system. The system ni is something that we define lah. Apa-apalah system yang kita define kan. Contohnya macam if let's say we define the phone as a system, then it is a system, and other than that, other than its boundary is what we call as surroundings. Okay? So when there is a system, there is energy in, there is energy out, there is some work in, there's also some work out. Okay? This is what we call as energy. For example here, okay, what is mentioned, when a body is left in a medium that is at a different temperature, energy transfer takes place between the body and the surrounding until the thermal equilibrium reach. So for example, like the system here, this is the surrounding. Imagine it is a room temperature, 25 degrees Celsius. The system itself is something that is very hot. Let's say imagine, ataupun we can say that the system is hot water just now. It is at 100 degrees Celsius. When you leave it for a while, it will reach what we call as thermal equilibrium. Okay? It will reach this, the thermal equilibrium, where actually the system and the surrounding will have the same temperature. Okay? So the direction of energy transfer is from higher temperature to lower temperature. And there is some kind of heat addition or heat rejection. For example, right now juga, eh, kalaulah surrounding dia lagi tinggi daripada sistem. Imagine ais ketul, eh. Ais ni sedap, nak makan buka puasa sekejap lagi. Ais ni, okay, is actually at 0 degrees Celsius, for example. And then the room temperature you expose, you put it at the room temperature. Room temperature is 25 degrees Celsius. Okay, after that, you will start to see that the ice melt. Why is that? Because the surrounding is transferring the heat from the surrounding to the ice itself. Okay, surrounding to the system. So this is what we call as heat addition to the system. If let's say the heat, ataupun kalau kita minum air panas, okay, teh yang panas, kita biar sekejap, and then lepas tu dia sejuk, this is what we call as heat rejection. Okay, because heat is being rejected to the surrounding. The energy is recognized as heat transfer only as it crosses the system boundary. I think this is very important as well that you have to remember. Energy is recognized as heat transfer only as it crosses the system boundary. System boundary kat mana? Okay, for example, like this is a system. So you define the system boundary. For example, like this dotted line is what we call a system boundary. Whatever that crosses the system, only then we say there is a heat transfer happen. But if let's say it's just within the system, okay, we don't say that there is a, we say there is no heat transfer. There is no heat transfer happen. Heat transfer only happen between system and the surrounding and surrounding to the system. Kalau system within system only, this is not, we don't call it as heat transfer. Okay, only when it crosses the boundary, then yes, there is a heat transfer happen. So the difference between heat transfer and work, it's what we call as an energy interaction. Is heat transfer, okay, an energy interaction is heat transfer if its driving force is a temperature different. As I mentioned earlier juga, kalau contohnya dia flow daripada high heat, high temperature kepada low temperature, okay, without having to do anything, that is what we call as heat. Tapi otherwise, kalau kita nak naikkan daripada low temperature kepada high temperature, this is what we call as work. We need to do some work to make sure that the temperature is increased. Okay. If you look at here, for example, which soda can does not have heat transfer? Do you have any idea? Okay, you can comment at the comment section. Which of the soda can kat sini yang tak berlaku heat transfer? Okay. Daripada mana kat sini? Kalau kita tengok kat sini, which one that doesn't have any heat transfer? Is it the soda with 25 degree? Is it the soda with 15? Or is it the soda with 5 degree Celsius? Okay. It is the first can of 25 degrees Celsius. What happened to this first can? What happened to this first can? What kind of phenomena that we call this first can? First can dengan room air ni. It reached what actually? It reached thermal equilibrium. Okay, thermal equilibrium. It reached thermal equilibrium because the room temperature dengan soda punya apa temperature tu sama. It is exactly the same. But what happened to this soda with 15 degrees Celsius and soda with 5 degrees Celsius ni? What do you think? After a while, what do you think of the temperature of the soda at 15 degrees and soda at 5 degrees Celsius when you expose it to the room air at 25 degrees Celsius? The temperature will increase, right? Temperature will increase until which temperature? Which, what do you think? Until 25. Dia tak akan pergi lebih. Dia tak akan pergi sampai 30. Okay? Dia akan sampai 25 juga. Because until it reach thermal equilibrium juga. So, kalau kita biar, contohnya, we take out ice. We take out ice and we put in at the room temperature. And you start, ice is melting. Okay? And what is actually the ice is trying to do is actually trying to reach thermal equilibrium with the room temperature. Okay, that's why the ice is melting. Okay, sampailah dia mencapai suhu yang sama dengan that particular room. So that is satu hukum dunia lah, the fitrah. That is a natural things to happen. Okay, when they put something, for example, the hot in a cold one, for example, it will try to make sure that the thermal equilibrium is being reached. So in this particular case, the soda at 25 degree will not have any kind of heat transfer. Okay, imagine this is a system, soda 25 degree, this is the surrounding, so there is no heat transfer. So if you ask what is the net heat transfer, it is equals to 0 kilojoule. 0 kilojoule, tak ada energy langsung. But is there any heat transfer between 25 and 15? Yes, there is a heat transfer because daripada surrounding is trying to put some heat inside soda yang 15 degrees Celsius supaya soda 15 degrees Celsius akan sama temperature dengan room air. Sama juga dengan case 5 degrees Celsius. Okay, so you can imagine that there will be more energy or the more heat added inside the soda with 5 degrees Celsius compared to 15 degrees Celsius in this particular case. Okay. So what is adiabatic process? Okay, adiabatic process is also something that you have to recall. A process during which there is no heat transfer. Okay. Maksudnya kat sini, the system tu is very well insulated. The system is very well insulated. So there is no energy coming in or there is no energy going out. There is no heat transfer at all lah. Okay. So this is what we call as adiabatic system. Okay. So how do we make the process tu is adiabatic? The system is well insulated. Maksudnya kalau kita buat properly insulate everything, macam contohnya kita buat isolated system, so that what we can get from as adiabatic system. Okay, or both system and surroundings are at same temperature or temperature. So for example, like in this particular case, kan, there is no heat transfer at all. So only then we'll be able to reach adiabatic system. Okay, so there are two conditions that we can get adiabatic system. Satu ialah when there is a proper insulation, and the second one is when there is system and the surrounding has the same temperature. So the mechanism of heat transfer, I think this is also what you learn in your physics long time ago at your school, kan? Secondary school. There are three types of heat transfer mechanism. One is conduction. So conduction ni is actually, kalau contohnya kalau kita letak tangan kita dekat satu objek yang panas, okay? For example, like that hot temperature tu, dia akan sentuh tangan kita. Kita akan rasa panas. Okay, kita akan rasa panas juga bila kita sentuh sesuatu yang panas. So that's what we call as conduction. Okay, conduction heat transfer. But if let's say there is a room, for example, you're putting your aircon, right? You're putting aircon, air condition. The cool one will go to the bottom, and then the hot one will rise to the top. Okay. So this is a convection. So dia akan berpusing kat situ. Transfer of energy between a solid surface and adjacent fluid. Okay. So this is where actually you can start to feel the cool air tu will go to the bottom, right? The cool air will go to the bottom and the hot air will rise. So this is where actually the convection punya happen. Okay. Convection of heat transfer. And then radiation. Radiation is where actually due to emission of electromagnetic waves. For example, like you put a radiator, okay, a radiator. Radiator dalam kereta, for example, if you have a car, there is a radiator inside the car, okay? So the radiator itself is actually emitting heat from that, okay? It's emitting heat from that. And this is what we call as a radiation punya heat transfer. So there are three types of heat transfer. One is conduction, another one is convection, and the one is radiation. So I would like you to think about along the way, for example, what would be the examples of heat transfer application that you can think of based on the above mechanism. Okay, there are so many application out there, okay, that you can think of, that is actually based on the heat transfer itself. For example, a kettle, electric kettle, what kind of heat transfer mechanism that you think happened there? Anyone have idea? Electric kettle. Is it conduction, convection, or radiation? Ada siapa-siapa boleh komen dekat chat section? Okay, electric kettle. Or an iron, for example. Iron. Electric iron, for example. What kind of heat transfer that take place over there? Okay. So kalau kita tengok kettle, electric kettle just now, there is a conduction. Okay, there is a conduction, there is a convection, there is also a radiation. Okay, so all of those three happen at the same time. For example, like iron, for example, what kind of heat transfer? For example, like when you start to iron your clothes, kan? I think that will be a relatively easy example to heat transfer happen from by conduction, okay? Because you put the iron straight on your clothes, because there is a solid, right? So it's an easily conduction happen, okay? All right, so you can try to think of other kind of application that is related to heat transfer. So in order for us to express the heat, okay, so we can express the heat by different notation lah. First of all, kalau kita tahu heat tu, we guna capital Q. Capital Q tu to express the heat, which is the energy as well. So it's measured in kilojoule. Okay? The unit is in kilojoule. But if let's say you have a small Q, so this is actually Q divided by M, which is the energy, the heat transfer Q divided by mass, heat transfer per unit mass. And the unit is kilojoule per kilogram. If let's say you have a Q dot, ni, this is what we call as energy heat transfer rate of heat transfer, okay? Rate of heat transfer. And then how do you get rate of heat transfer is basically the energy Q, the heat transfer Q divided by delta T. Delta T tu ialah selang masa, how long does that the energy is being transferred, okay? And then if let's say you have amount of heat transfer when heat transfer rate changes with time. Yang ini with the condition that the heat transfer rate is consistent. It's the same throughout the period. But when there is a change of heat transfer rate, for example, at time equals to 1, heat transfer rate is different, 5. At time equals to 2 second, and the heat transfer rate become different. Okay. So you need, in order for us to calculate Q, then it is an integral between from time 1 to time 2 of the heat transfer rate by with respect to dt. Okay, so if let's say you have a system here, and then this is a surrounding, okay, daripada surrounding you have a transfer of 30 kilojoule of heat to the system. So we can simply say that there is an energy, the heat transfer rate, the heat transfer is 30 kilojoule, but at the same time the system itself having a mass of 2 kilogram. So when you divide 30 by 2, then you can get the Q, the small Q, as 15 kilojoule per kilogram. This is what we call as heat transfer per unit mass, okay? And because the duration of the transfer is 5 seconds and the heat transfer rate is consistent, it's constant throughout 5 seconds. So in order for us to know the heat transfer rate is actually 30 divided by 5, then this is where actually you got 6 kilowatt, which is equivalent to the power. Okay, so kalau kita tengok certain kind of electrical equipment, you'll be able to see the power. Okay, you start to see the power. For example, like this is berapa power dia, 100 kilowatt, for example, lampu, for example, which means that throughout kita pasang at any time pun dia akan emit that particular power at that particular time. Okay, because the heat transfer rate is constant. So this is defined by unit power, 6 kilowatt. Okay, so this is how you'll be able to express heat. So if let's say we are doing heat transfer, but then by work, imagine again, kalau kita buat work, work is actually you have, in order for us to increase the temperature kan, daripada benda yang sejuk kita nak panaskan, then we have to do work. So work here is defined as the energy transfer associated with a force acting through a distance. For example, like a rising piston, a rotating shaft, and electric wire crossing the system boundaries are all associated with work interaction. Okay. Imagine tadi tengok water ni tadi, this water bottle. Sekarang ni, saya boleh naikkan temperature of water ni kepada 1 degree without having to put any kind of heat kat sini. How I can do that? Can you suggest ways how I can increase the water punya temperature ni daripada 25 degree contohnya naik 26 degree without giving any heat source? Siapa boleh cadangkan? Anybody can suggest something? Try to write down in the chat section. Lowering the room temperature, not really. Apa lagi yang saya boleh buat in order for me to just rise up the temperature daripada, let's say water temperature ni 25 degrees Celsius, I want to make it to 26 or 27 degrees Celsius. What I could do in order for me to make sure that the water can increase the temperature without I put any heat source. Maksudnya heat source tadi macam letak api ke apa semua kan. I don't put that. But I change it. I do different thing. So what are the that different thing I can do in order for me to make the temperature rise? Kalau wrap the bottle with full. Okay. Buka penutup. Buka penutup dia dah jadi open system. I want to make it maintain as a closed system. What can I do? Hold the bottle with bare hand, also with providing heat source. So it's not considered as also put under your armpit also cannot be done because it's also providing heat source. Okay, Pechi, that's right. Shake the bottle. Shake the bottle is actually shake the bottle ni if you are doing vigorously. Okay. This is where actually you providing work. You provide work to that this bottle. Okay, you provide work to this bottle. Ataupun for example like you put a propeller. Okay, you put a propeller and then lepas tu kita putarkan. Ataupun kita masukkan dalam blender for example kan. Kita ada blender. So it's actually blending the water kan. The mix all this inside here. So this is where actually work is being done. Okay, this is what does it mean by work. So kat sini macam a rising piston, a rotating shaft, electric wire crossing the system. These are all associated with work interaction. So you are doing work to make sure that the temperature is rise up. Okay? So that is where actually you need to do some kind of extra effort, what we call as work, to make sure that the temperature is rise up. Okay, so heat. So kalau kita tengok convention kat sini, heat transfer to a system and work done by a system is what we call as positive. Heat transfer from a system and work done on a system are negative. What is meant here is that, okay, if let's say there is a heat being transferred to the system, maksudnya daripada luar, daripada tadi katalah contohnya kita ada room temperature of 25 degrees Celsius and ice of 0 degrees Celsius. So the heat transfer daripada surrounding kepada system, this you will get a positive sign. Maksudnya the system itself gaining energy lah, gaining heat kat situ. Okay. So at the same time, if let's say the system is doing some work, okay, so also it is you got a positive sign. Tapi kalau heat transfer from system, which means that kalau you have a hot water 100 degrees Celsius and lepas tu dia transfer heat kepada surrounding because the surrounding is much more cooler. Okay, so this is where actually you are losing energy. So the sign is negative. Okay, the sign is negative. Similarly, if let's say the work is done on a system, that is also considered as negative. Okay. What it's meant by work done by a system tadi macam saya shake tadi. There is a system, I shake it. So I'm actually providing it's a negative sign. Okay. So alternative to sign convention is to use subscripts in and out to indicate direction. This is the primary approach in this text. So untuk memudahkan cara, instead of using positive ke negative ke, kita just guna in or out. Energy in or energy out. Or work in or work out. Okay. So work done by unit mass also can be done by W divided by M, and you can get the power, which is power is the work done per unit time, which is in kilowatt. If you okay, know that you have the slide in Google Classroom kan, dah ada slide tu, page 20 dengan page 21. Okay, I would like you to go through this slide, page 20 and 21. Spend the next 3 minutes, I think 2 minutes, 3 minutes lah, 3 minutes. Try to read this on your own first. After that, I'm going to put you into breakout session for the next 5 minutes. I would like you to discuss about what you understand from the figure and from the points that I have written here. That is one task. Second task is I would like you to have this thinking time. For example, you look at this particular process and try to answer part A and part B. So the next 3 minutes, please read on your own first. Okay, read on your own. Lepas tu saya akan bagikan you all kepada group kecil. You will discuss that. And then you will share the answer. Only one per one rep per member akan answer dekat letak dekat Mentimeter. Okay. So it starts now until 6:12. Do your own reading first for these two slides. When I ask you to discuss later on, okay, when I ask you to discuss later on, is try to relate with some kind of example. Only then it makes sense to you, okay? So in 1 minute, I'm going to put every one of you in the breakout rooms, okay? So you will need to discuss with each other about what you understand from the slide and answer this part. A candle is burning in a well-insulated room. Okay? Slide 21, slide 20 and 21. Okay, so now I'm going to put you in the breakout room. So I hope that you could participate for the next 5 minutes, okay, until 6:17 to discuss about these two slides. Okay, for this Mentimeter punya question is just for slide number 20. So you just write down on what you understand from slide number 20. Nanti slide number 21 will be on the next slide. Okay. Not yet. You don't answer yet. The slide 21 ni. Slide 20 first. Slide 20 ni yang ini.
Soalannya apa?
The one that you are actually answering right now yang kata there is heat transfer or not tu is actually slide 21. So I would like you to attempt first the slide 20. Slide 20 yang ini. Okay. Heat and work. What do you understand from this? From this point and the figure. Please write a bit longer eh, sebab I pun I cannot figure out when you would write example hot air balloon, what does it mean? So what actually that you understood from the slide itself? That those are the things that I ask you. Okay, tengok balik slide 20. Slide 20 ni bukan slide 21. Slide 21 ni pasal candle kan? Okay, slide 21 pasal candle. Tapi slide 20 dulu. I would like you to get some concept first. If you realize eh, for the past, untuk dua lecture ni, I didn't give you any kind of calculation whatsoever yet because I wanted to get through the concept first. The fundamental tu you kena faham tu betul. Only then, kalau bagi soalan apa-apa pun, you be able to answer that. So the first thing first is lah kita kena dissect dulu apa benda yang kita tak faham. There is no heat or work if the system possesses energy, okay? Both heat and work are processes which is associated with the boundaries of the system. Okay, that is one of your conclusion. What are other things that you can figure out when you go through to this slide actually? Eh? Bila tengok slide 20 ni apa yang you all nampak lagi? System possesses energy with a process. System is a process and it has energy. Heat and work has past function. Okay. Heat and work are similar. Heat and work only appear in boundaries. They are past function. Okay. This look better. The understanding. There can be an increase in heat by using work and no application of heat. Okay. Alright. Tak apa. I think there is some mixed understanding from the slide. What you read, I will explain further later. So my question right now, candle in a room, is there any heat transfer during this burning process? Okay, so many of you said there is no heat transfer during this burning process. Can you comment why do you think there is no heat transfer at the burning process, during the burning process in the candle room tu? What do you think? Kenapa tidak ada heat transfer? Okay, because it is well insulated. Because it is well insulated, it is actually adiabatic process. Well done. Faham pun. That's good. Okay. It is adiabatic process. Okay, because heat transfer only happen between system and surrounding, right? And it, since it is an insulated, well insulated, so there is no heat crossing the boundary. Heat tu tak cross the boundary, dia tak pergi ke surrounding. Walaupun bilik tu makin lama makin panas, makin lama makin panas, still there is no heat transfer between the system to the surrounding. Itu yang candle in the room. Okay, the second one. is there any change in the internal energy of the system? Yes, no, or not sure? Berbelah bahagi ni, perasaan berbelah bahagi. Senang-senang jawab not sure je kan. Is there any change in internal energy of the system? The answer is yes. Okay, kenapa? Okay, kenapa? If you remember the microscopic energy tadi kan. Microscopic energy tu ialah consists of internal energy. So sebenarnya bila room tu makin panas, molekul dalam room tu dia makin bergerak lagi pantas. Okay, it works faster. It collide with each other and it works, the molecule move faster. So the temperature is actually within that particular room itself is increasing. So internal energy dia memang naik. Tapi there is no heat transfer sebab there is no heat going out from that room. Kan? Kalau kita pasang candle tu memang room tu akan panas. Maksudnya temperature akan naik. Okay? Tapi again, that so what we call that internal energy, there is a change of internal energy because there is a change of the temperature within that particular room. Okay, so going back to this slide, in slide 20, what can we understand from here is actually, first of all, kita kena kata heat and work are recognized at the boundaries of the system. As I mentioned earlier, kalau the heat tu does not cross the system punya boundary, there is no heat transfer. Okay, so kalau they cross the boundary, baru kita consider there is a heat transfer. Systems possess energy but not heat or work. Okay, dalam sistem tu dia ada possess energy, tapi dia heat or work ni actually dia cuma related kepada path functions. Okay. Both are associated with a process, not a state. Okay, both are work and heat are related to the process. So if you look at this point, this is a pressure property. Another one is volume, and then there is an expansion. For example, from 2 meter cube kepada 5 meter cube, and there are two type of process here: process A as well as process B. And process A it requires the magnitude of work tu is smaller compared to process B. So maksudnya nak dapatkan daripada point 1 sampai ke point 2, there will be a change. Okay, so now you can see that there is a change of property. Dekat point 1 is 2 meter cube, dekat point 2 is 5 meter cube, and then you can see that the magnitude is different for the work itself. Maksudnya work A ni 8 kilojoule, work B is 12 kilojoule. So both are associated with a process. Maksudnya heat or work is associated with the process, not a state. Unlike the properties, heat or work has no meaning at the state. Maksudnya kalau you nak try to define what is the heat at point 1, you cannot mention it. You don't have the idea. You cannot define it. What is the point at point 1 and point 2? You cannot say my work at point 2 is like this. You cannot. You can only define the magnitude of the work or the magnitude of the heat based on the process itself. Okay? Both are path function, which means that their magnitudes depend on the path followed by during a process as well as the end state. So you can have a change from point 1 to point 2 with a different process and with a different heat or work amount, energy itself. Dari segi energy dia akan berbeza-beza. Okay, there is a different that. So properties are point functions, but heat and work are path functions. Okay, so that is very important that we need to know lah. Okay. Okay, so here this is where actually kita mention pasal room tadi. So again, because this is well insulated, there is no heat transfer because the surrounding dengan system tu tak ada heat transfer because it is well insulated. But within itself, there is an increase of the internal energy of the system. Okay. Now it is already 6:30. Okay, what I will do is actually I will further record my video, small videos, so that you will be able to enjoy the last few slides kat sini. Because it's going to take some time juga for me to explain to you. Is that okay with you? Sebab kalau tidak, kalau kita tak stop nanti ada nak kena tolong mak ayah pula untuk nak berbuka semua kan. So I try to record a video and then we'll be able to, so you'll be able to complete the lecture on your own. Alright? Okay, before that, let me ask you one last question. Can you just quickly recap what you learned today? So at least I know what actually that you have in mind. What do you think that you have learned? Last recorded video, yes. I will share in the classroom, Google Classroom nanti. Okay? It is uploaded in my cloud. Nanti I kena download and I pass to you. So for now, can you just share with me ada what you learned today in Mentimeter? Some of you will always come with many useful knowledge. Okay. Okay, so today we learn about heat transfer. I hope that you'll be able to differentiate what is heat, what is work, and how does heat being transferred from system to the surrounding, from surrounding to the system, and so on. Okay, well done. All right. Last one before... Okay, this is still coming up. Okay, good. Okay, so the last one. Last slide. My thoughts about thermodynamics so far. What do you think about thermodynamics so far? This is the last one, eh? Nothing else. I will not ask you something else. Difficult, okay. So far, not so hard. Okay. All right. Okay. It's about energy, didn't know, can be very complicated. Okay. All right. Sub water. Okay. Right. So yes, it's getting harder. but the most important part is actually the first few weeks is you need to grasp the concept. Once you need to grasp the concept, okay. Once you get the concept very well, okay, then you'll be able to understand further the application later on. Because whatever it is, the first few weeks, the first 5 weeks is about getting the fundamentals. So fundamentals is a bit tough. You need to understand the fundamentals. Once you move into other parts application later on, once you recall, you tahu, clearly tahu apa itu path, apa itu process, what is the surrounding, what is system, what is closed open, what is isobaric, isochoric, whatsoever. Once you understand that very well, and you know how does the heat being transferred, okay, and so on, then you'll be able to do the further calculation in the application part. So that is why it's a bit, give you sometimes to really master the concept, master the topic. At the same time, I also recommend you to get the books, the textbook here. Okay, this is a thermodynamics textbook. Yusuf Yunus Eşengel from Turkish professor. I know that now we have latest edition. So that textbook will give you extra information about what is it all about dalam thermodynamics. Okay. All right, so I think that's all. So I'll see you next Monday. But by the way, inshallah, I'll try to give you the video maybe tonight or tomorrow. Okay, by tonight or tomorrow, I'll complete the lecture and I'll pass to you. So thank you. Take care, everyone. Have a good day. Yeah.
So, yang background colour tu, slide 24 tu
warna
hijau ke?
Okay, tak, bukan warna hijau, sekejap. So, let me show you the background colour. Tak sampai slide 24 tadi. Okay, this is slide number 24. So, siapa yang ada nak jawab?
Lain, lain.
Lain. Saja tukar. Not hijau. I know that someone have submitted, it's okay. Alright, so okay, take care everyone. Bye-bye.
Selamat berbuka.
Selamat buka semua. Assalamualaikum and good day.
Thank you sir, selamat berbuka.
Thank you.
Thank you sir.
Thank you sir. Selamat berbuka.
Thank you.